on the furs, laying up my treasures at home above, trusting, fully trusting in the Savior's love, doing what I can for heaven's holy dove. I'm getting ready to leave this world, getting ready. Trusting in the riches of the saving grace, pain, earthly trial, I just can't trace. Sure that up in heaven I can find a place. I'm getting ready to leave this world, getting ready to leave this world, getting ready for the gates of pearl. Keep me watching. To prepare a mansion, Jesus said, I go. If it were not true, I would have told you so. Just a little while to live here below. I'm getting ready to leave this world. Get ready to leave this world. Get ready for the gates of pearl. Keeping watching.
Sing on. Amen. Praise God. Amen.
I love the blessed Savior divine. He brightens up this pathway of mine. From his dear side I'll never. I'll follow wheresoever he leads my soul. Each day he tenderly feeds. I love the Lord deep down in my heart. I love the Lord deep down in my heart. Not an earthly change can cause to part. I've been made a child. From day to day, he's leading me on to that bright bed of beautiful dawn. From his dear side, I'll never depart. And too, I'll learn more from my sea when I have crossed life's mystical sea. I love the Lord deep down in my heart. I love the such boundless, precious glory, the Savior sends from heaven above. From his dear I'll never depart. It fills my soul with wonderful joy, drives away the things that annoy. I love the Lord deep down in my heart. I love the Lord. Sing the chorus one more time. Here we go. I love the Lord deep down in my heart.
chorus one more time. Let's sing it again. Here we go. I've been made a child with a homeward star. I love the Lord deep down in my heart.
God's people said,
amen.
How many of you love the Lord this morning? Praise God. I think they said many years ago, P.P. Bliss, when he was a young songwriter and a young evangelist, he wrote the song, Oh, How I Love Jesus. But said when he came to the end of his ministry and came to the end of his life, he penned another song and said, I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. I'm glad, thank God, not only do I love him, but I love him because according to the word of God, he first loved me. And I bless his name for it. Brother Ben, ask God's help on the service today. Yes, thank you, Lord, for the good thing. God, help me. Amen. You can be seated. Let me say a word of welcome to you. I appreciate you being in the Lord's house today. And man, we've got several families visiting with us, and I thank you for being here today. I think one of our ushers would have given you a visitor's package, and if that visitor card that's in that packet, if you'll just drop that in the offering plate as it comes by in just a moment, we'd like to have a record of your visit, and we trust and pray that the service will be a real blessing to you this morning, and God will speak to your heart. We thank you for being here. Let me say, man, we've had a great weekend. We've been up in Brother Dave and the kids and some of our adults went with us. We went up to Brother Lee Davis's there at Georgetown Baptist Church in Leicester, North Carolina, just right outside of Asheville, and had a great trip. I think we took, I want to say, about 45 people, I think. Man, the bus was full. The others were full. And one of our young ladies that went with us got saved on Friday night. And to God be the glory for that. And I want to say to our young people, a lot of them are in here this morning. Man, what a great job our young people did behaving. I mean, it was just a tremendous. Bear said, I think, stood up on the bus on one of the best groups, one of the best trips we've ever had. And I want to tell them I appreciate that. And what a good testimony that is. I think Ms. Joyce said yesterday at lunch that even some of the Georgetown folks had commented on how well our young people behaved. And let me say, the better we behave, the more we go. Say amen right there. And I praise the Lord for these young people. And man, we heard some great preaching. And Brother Steve Cox did a tremendous job. And then yesterday morning, Brother Josh Helton. And then, man, it was vintage Brother Lee Davis. Have you ever heard Brother Lee Davis? One of the most practical men of God you've ever heard preach. And man, he preached. I promise you this. He preached a message yesterday morning that every mom and dad would be glad their teenager heard. Amen. I mean, it was just one of those. He said, number one, man, Brother John, he said, number one, out there, he was busting our hide. He said, he talked about having good success out of Joshua 1:8. And he said, number one, if you're going to have to get good success, and I mean, man, I was dead as a hammer. He said, get up. And I thought, oh, my. He said, some of you teenage boys don't know there's 2 6 o'clocks in the morning. I was back there going, I'm like, man, I would. He told me, he said, if I didn't put my alarm clock on the other side of the room, he said, I'd shoot it in the morning. But he talked about get up, show up, and man up, and all kind of stuff. It was wonderful. And talking about these young people growing up, and I thought, man, I just, you know, I bowed my head. I was like, oh, my. But Brother Davis did a great job. And I thank the Lord for it, and I praise God for his help. And then, man, last night, Brother Cox preached again. And I thank the Lord for our young people. We're going to take up an offering here at the end of the service. I told you last week, we had several kids that ride our vans that we allowed to go, and we want to take up. I told you we'd sponsor that. I think probably the trip costs about $2,000 to do between the food and everything. So, man, if you want to sponsor one of these kids, we need to raise a good bit of money this morning. And if you want to sponsor one of these kids, I promise you this, it was worth every dime. That little girl getting saved was worth every dime, every dollar, every piece of time that was done. And I praise the Lord for it. But we'll receive that offering at the end of the service. But then this morning, our building fund offering, everything you take up will go toward our building fund. So you be much in prayer about what God will have you do there. Then tonight, it's Youth Sunday. It's Fifth Sunday. We have Youth Sunday. And I've asked Brother Jared Dixon to come in and preach for us tonight, be preaching to our young people. And then after service, we'll be baptizing. We've got several to baptize tonight, and I'm excited about that. So you'll be back in your place. I want to meet with our folks that are getting baptized just after service for just a moment. And so we'll do that after service. Then Wednesday night, Brother John will be preaching Wednesday night in the Wednesday night service. So you pray for him. God will help him. I'll be in two different meetings this week. Be in King, North Carolina for a couple of days. And then, Lord's will, I'm going to have the opportunity to preach at the Trinity Baptist Church in Moxville. You pray for me. They said on Friday night, probably over 1,000 teenagers there. And, man, I don't want to see God let me be a blessing and reach these young people. I've got a heart to see another generation reach with the gospel of the Lord Jesus. And so you pray that God will help us. They're putting a 1,000-seat tent up, man. I'm excited about that. Pray. I told Brother John Morgan that. He got so happy he's coming to the meeting. He just wants to see that big old tent, praise God. And so I praise the Lord for it. So you pray God will help us this week. And pray for Brother John. He'll be preaching Wednesday night. Brother Jared tonight, I'm going to let you have off for choir practice. A lot of our adults went with us this weekend. And, man, and it's been a long. They got up early this morning to come home. Appreciate Papa Bear driving them, getting us there saved. Brother David, all the ones that went with us, I appreciate everything that was done to make the trip this weekend a success, and I praise the Lord for it. All right, Brother Ron, if you and the men will come on, we'll receive our morning tithes and offerings, our building fund offering. We do that on the fifth Sunday. So we need to, you be much in prayer about what the Lord will have you to do, and God will help us with that. Amen. Again, we appreciate all our visitors being here. You be faithful and you give into the Lord's house. All right. You pray for the choir this morning. It'll be a blessing. Let's start. We're going to start that there in a moment. And I shall return. All right. Here we go. Let's see. 6-1. Then we're going to do 3rd and 9th. 6-1. Let's see. Yeah.
far Easter country, a great general stood in tears as he sadly watched his men face defeat. He'd bravely fought the battle, though it seemed it was in vain, for now all he could do was retreat. But just as he was leaving, he turned and one last time he looked and saw the fear in their eyes.
With a voice as loud as thunder, calmly reassuring, he made them this promise and saluted them goodbye.
But he conquered death and hell in just 3 days. Now that he was leaving, fear had gripped their hearts. They knew the time had come to say goodbye.
But before he ascended back to his Father, he made them this promise as he rose up through the sky.
Yeah, you're right, Brother John. Our dad is coming. Amen. Praise God. It is going to get dark. I told Brother Mark, before we got ready to sing that song, I said, man, it excites me more than it ever has. Man, a lot of us have thought Russ has just been dead and all this year. She's come back alive. You say, why? Because she's got to figure in that end time, friend. Hey, I tell you what, it's going to happen just like what the Lord said it was going to happen. And I say with John the Revelator, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Praise God. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. Praise God, friend. I'm glad I've got the reservations on another shore. Bless his name. I'm glad this is not it. I'm glad I've got a good morning to look forward to. Praise God. Let's sing it. With your neighbor while the choir comes down. How many of you glad he called you out? Praise God. Amen. Brother Mark's going to come sing. Had this song on my heart. I guess it's been since maybe last year, revival time last year, since I heard him sing it. But boy, it's a blessing. Been on my mind. Been studying back in the book of Ruth all week again this week. Been preaching through it. And it's just a story of the grace of God. Brother Cox preached last night about Oatai that went over there to serve David. Oatai was a Philistine. Oatai didn't even belong. But he told David, he said, as long as the Lord liveth, as long as the king liveth, he said, it don't matter where you go, I'm going to worship you and serve you. And that's where we were, man. We didn't deserve to get in. We were under a curse. But by the grace of God, he allowed every one of us to be a part of the Lord's family. And I say to God be the glory. You listen to him while brother.
Lord, I know that when you saved me, you put them all under the blood. And every sin that I'll ever do is washed beneath the flood. Lord, I know that I'm unworthy, and I feel so ashamed to keep coming back time and time again, always for the same old thing. What I need is more grace. Though I'm guilty, will you plead my case? Lord, I tried, but I failed again. So what I'm asking for is more grace. I'll tell you this, there's enough to go around. Lord, I'm trying hard to follow. I keep getting off track. For every step that I take forward, seems I'm taking two steps back. I'm not seeking signs and wonders, just searching for a space of grace. Running to my place of refuge, strength enough to run this race. What I need is more grace. Though I'm guilty, would you plead my case? Lord, I tried, but I failed again. So what I'm asking for is more grace.
Your Bible, open it to the book of Ruth in chapter number 1. The book of Ruth in chapter number 1. Don't you appreciate that good song? I'm glad when I need more grace, it's available. Amen. Like Brother Mark said, there's enough to go around, praise God. Amen. Ruth chapter number 1, we'll read one verse in chapter number 1, and then I want to read one verse in chapter number 2, and we'll ask the Lord to help us this morning. Ruth chapter number 1, stand with me when you find your place. And the Bible said in chapter 1 and verse number 22, so Naomi and Ruth, the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, which returned out of the country of Moab, they came to Bethlehem in the beginning of the barley harvest. Now, look in chapter number 2 and verse number 23. So she kept fast by the maidens of Boaz to glean unto the end of the barley harvest and of the wheat harvest, and dwelt with her mother-in-law. You can be seated. If you underline in your Bible, I want you to take your pen, and some of you preachers probably already know where I'm headed. But you can. I want you to underline two phrases in these chapters, or these verses. Verse number 22 of chapter number 1, the latter part of the verse said, they came to Bethlehem. Then notice the next phrase, in the beginning of the barley harvest. Now notice verse 23 of chapter 2. So she kept fast by the maidens of Boaz to glean. Now notice the second phrase I'm interested in. Unto the end of barley harvest and of wheat harvest. And I want to preach this morning, as I got to studying last week and reading again, I noticed that Ruth came at the beginning and she persevered and she stayed and she labored until the end. Man, I tell you what, sometimes in my Christian life, and I believe you would say in your Christian life, sometimes the end seems far off. Just like Brother John just testified, there's sometimes, neighbor, that it seems like that nighttime hour, that time when they promise they're going to be back, it seems like it's a long way away. Brother Mark, we go through dry times, and we go through difficult times, and we go through discouraging times, and it seems like the end is not in sight. It seems like we're never going to get there. It seems like heaven is just a fairy tale. It seems like that place that we read about where our burden is going to be lifted and we're going to see the Lord face to face. It seems like it's never going to get here. It's never going to get here. And I believe, as we've talked in days gone by, I believe that the greatest fear of the Apostle Paul was voiced when he wrote the verse that he said, though I preach to others, he said that I myself might become a castaway. Man, I tell you what scares me. I don't want to fall out before the end. I don't want to kick out, Brother Darren, until the Lord comes back. I don't want to, listen, now when he comes back, I don't want to find me in some dance hall somewhere or somewhere out in the world living in sin. He said, will the Lord find faith when he comes? Hey, I don't want to have to come looking for me when he comes back or be ashamed at where I am when he comes back. I want to stay in this thing until the Lord makes his way back. It breaks my heart, Brother Mark, when I look at men that we've looked up to that have been our heroes. That in years go by, Brother John, they have they've prodded us and they've charged us to stand true. But now they're going back on what they preached. They're changing Bibles. They're changing their methodology. But God help, I don't want to change. I don't want to be different. I want to finish the way God let me get in this thing. God help me not to fall out. And I want to preach for just a little while this morning. You pray for me. I thought when I read that verse where it said until the end or unto the end of the barley harvest, these words came in my mind. My heart can sing when I pause to remember a heartache here is but a stepping stone along a trail that's winding always upward. This troubled world is not my final home. And I can hear that choir as a boy, they'd sing, But until then, my heart will go on singing. Until then, with joy, I'll carry on. Until the day my eyes behold that city. Until the day he calls me home. How many of you remember, as some of us as children, those old choirs singing that old song? And for a little while, I want to preach this morning on until then. Until then. Hey, the Bible said he wanted to finish his course with joy. And Brother Mark, I believe in chapter number 2 of the book of Ruth, I believe the Lord gives us some things, if we'll practice them in our daily life, that will help us make it from the beginning until the end. God, help us not to fall out. May I say some things about this work of gleaning? Can I say it's difficult work? It was difficult work. Hey, they were walking in that hot Middle Eastern sun, bent over and gathering up for hours on end and hours on end. And may I say to you, this thing called the Christian life is not for weak-minded folk. The world wants to say we're weak-minded and we have had something to depend on. Let me say to you, the world and folks that are lost, this is the best world they'll ever live in. But Brother Kobe, this is not the best world. We're getting our judgment now as we judge ourselves. And God judges to get that sin out of us. But this thing called the Christian life, there are seasons of difficulty. But may I say to you, this thing of the Christian life and this matter of gleaning, it's not only difficult work, it's deliberate work. She said, Brother Mark, Naomi said, or Ruth said to Naomi, let me now go glean. I believe some of us think that we're just going to serve God by accident. We're just going to wake up one day and go about our business and whoops, I served the Lord. By some circumstance or just by what the world would call luck or good fortune. May I tell you, if we're going to serve God in this day, it's going to be a deliberate work. It's going to be something that we have to do on purpose. Can I tell you why I came to church? I came to church on purpose this morning. Hey, man, I went to Brother Davis's this weekend on purpose. You got on that plane on Wednesday afternoon, you and Will, to go all the way across the country to Alaska to preach and sing. You didn't do that by accident. There was plans made. There were arrangements made. There were prayers made. There was studying made. You made it to Alaska on purpose. Amen. And can I tell you, if you're going to serve God, young person, mom and dad, if you're going to serve God, it's going to take some deliberate acts. Paul said, 2 Corinthians 11:1, when I determined with myself, in other words, when he made up his mind, I'm going to tell you, when you're going to serve God, when you decide to. When you decide to. You know when you'll come to visitation? When you decide to. Amen. You know when you'll make it back to Sunday night service? When you decide to. Amen. Hey man, I'm not fussing or being mean. I'm just saying, hey, when we decide to do it, hey, I appreciate these kids that ride our vans. They don't have to come. Brother John, they're not being made to come. Their moms and dads aren't forcing them to come. They get up of their own volition. They put their clothes on. Maybe everybody else in the house is still asleep, yet they get up and come to church. Can I tell you why y'all got on the bus? Well, y'all didn't have a choice this morning. It was either get on the bus or be in North Carolina. Amen. But Wednesday afternoon when the bus rolls through your little neighborhood, the reason you're on the bus is because you made a choice to get on the bus. Nobody walked in your house, got you by the hair of the head, drug you out of the house and put you on the bus. Amen. And may I say to you, blessed be God, that same kind of determination, that same kind of character, that same kind of fortitude needs to show up in some of our lives if we're going to do something for God. I got to thinking this weekend, Brother Mark, the theme at Brother Davis's was keep the charge. And man, I got to thinking about Hebrews 10:25. Not forsaking this first assembly of yourselves together, as the manner of some is, but listen, exhorting one another, and so much the more. I thought we are living in a so much the more generation. We're living in a generation, Brother John, they want to back off. Things they used to do, they said we don't need to do them anymore. But according to that verse, it's not a so much the less generation. It's a so much the more generation. If we used to have two revivals, we at least probably ought to have three. And if we used to have three, we probably ought to have four. If you used to pray 30 minutes, you probably ought to pray an hour. It's not a so much the less. It's a so much the more generation. It's deliberate work. It's difficult work. Can I say this matter of gleaning? It's dangerous work. Brother Davey, a lot of those men, those reapers in those fields, they weren't church-going men. They weren't what we would call high-character individuals. Amen. They might have been some rough neck boys. You say, why do you think that? Because history bears that out. But Boaz thought enough about it, he had to tell them to keep their hands off Ruth. What about that, Brother John? I wish I had my voice so I could, praise God. What about the fact that we're serving a God who's big enough and bad enough that he can look at the powers of darkness and the powers of evil, hallelujah, and look at them and say, keep your hands off. Hallelujah. Oh, blessed be God. I'm not serving some effeminate Jesus walking around with, listen, saying peace to the world. But I'm serving the captain of the Lord's army. And even when he looks the devil and all his imps of hell in the eye and says, keep your hands off. I'm glad, thank God, it is a dangerous world. But Brother Mark, thank God, we serve the King of the universe. And thank God when he gets ready to tell somebody to keep their hands off of us. I'm glad they've got to do it. That ain't helping some of you like it ought to be, praise God. I feel a little Brother Dean spirit coming on me. I'm going to call that black choir out of Atlanta to come sing, praise God. Y'all don't help me. Hey, Brother Ricky Gravis said last week, said every church member ought to say amen 15 to 25 times at every service. I feel good about that. You say, why? Well, that word amen means that is the truth. You say you got Bible for that? There's a whole lot more than 25 amens in that Bible. Hallelujah. Amen. Difficult. Hey, young person, I don't pretend it's easy to go to school and live for God. But listen here, I've got a God in heaven that knows where you are, knows the difficulty. And if you want to live for God, he can tell the world to keep their hands off. Man, I feel God right there. Hallelujah. Amen. What about the fact we go out into the world tomorrow? Man, we're walking and there's an angel in front of us. According to the Psalms, they're encamped all around us. And them demons come and he said, hands off, hands off. Don't you touch him. You say, I believe it's just like that, Brother Mike. I'm glad I'm surrounded by a heavenly presence that's got the power and authority. And when he says hands off, it's hands off. Matter of fact, Brother Avery, I didn't even see them man question Boaz. I didn't hear them back talk him. I didn't even hear them accuse her. He said, hands off. And they said, yes, sir. Glory. That's helping me. I don't know about y'all. Hey, man. I mean, praise God. I mean, listen, I've told folks before, you mess with me and probably get away with some things. But you mess with her, or you mess with one of them boys, you're probably going to see a side of Brother Mark you don't want to see. Amen. Brother Mark, you probably, there might be some things you can do to Christ and say about Christ, he might be long-suffering. But I believe when you mistreat his bride, Amen. If that's in you and I as an earthly man, Brother Darren, if it's in you to protect Sister Kim as an earthly man, I got something. We didn't die for our wives. He died for his. He wrote her a whole book. Amen. He wrote her a whole story and said, I love you from Genesis to Revelation. And if he thought that much, man, there ain't none of that in the notes. But it's preaching pretty good right now, amen. Hey, if he thought so much of her, oh, that he took the grandest thing that heaven had and gave it to the world to give us a gift and to pay our ransom, don't you believe that he's got something vested and he loves the bride? And when the devil messes with the bride, he gets on the wrong side of the Father. It's a difficult time. It's a deliberate time. It's a dangerous time. May I say to you this morning, I believe the Word of God sets out some things. Young person, some of you are just getting started in this thing. Montana, you just got saved Friday night. Can I get a witness right there? Man, that would have been all right if we was at the Presbyterian Church wearing robes and preaching Calvinist doctrine. Everybody okay? I said, Montana got saved Friday night. Hey, man. And she's just getting started. But I believe the Lord lays out some principles in Ruth 2, Miss Selena, that if we'll put them into practice, we'll not only be in the beginning, but we'll still be in the field at the end. Amen. Amen. I don't want to be a flashing star. I don't want to be a flash in the pan. I want to be around when he comes back, praise God. Amen. Number one, look at your Bible. We're going to look for verse number eight on through the rest of the chapter. I want you to notice verse number eight. Look at your Bible. The Bible said, then said Boaz and Ruth, here's they're not my daughter. Go not to glean another field, neither go from hence, but abide here fast by me. Let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go after them. Have I not charged the young men? They shall not touch thee. Notice this next phrase. And when thou art athirst, go unto the vessels and drink. You know why I drank right there? Number one, I'm thirsty. Number two, because I wanted to. And number three, because it was available. Amen. You want to wait from the beginning, you want to make it from the beginning to the ending. What are you going to do? Number one, you're going to have to be a sipping Christian. You're going to have to be a sipping Christian. See, a lot of us have got to, we've got under the impression that it's always got to be a big drink. We think that, man, if Lord, if it ain't just poured out of heaven by the boatloads or by the bucketfuls, that God ain't helping us. I mean, man, some of us are living from one major event. Brother Lee said it Friday night before we started the youth meeting. One of the greatest dangers of young people, they're trying to live from one large event to another large event to another large event. But I'm telling you what, the majority of our Christian life, it's not a big event. It's not some grand thing. But it's day by day. You get up and sip a little bit. He said it. Brother Willard used to preach it. He said that most of the entries in Christopher Columbus's logbook, when they were looking for America, was this. It wasn't we didn't see land. It wasn't we discovered this. But day after day, he logged in the phrase, today we sailed on. Amen. And may I say to you, we ought to log into our Christian journal. Today we sipped on. Today we sipped on. Today we sipped on. Why? Because we're in a dry, thirsty land. But they God, there's water available. Some of you are real nervous. I got this water in my hand. I think I'm going to start preaching every Sunday with water in my hand. Some of you are listening like y'all ain't listened since. Praise God. I mean, man, their eyes, Brother Mark. I mean, when I shook that water, they said. And I have been known to get happy and just shower the whole crowd. Hey, man. What about that? When we get dry, Brother Kofi, there's water in this field. The priority of the water. First thing he talked to her about was the water. You study it out this way in your Bible, when you find water that's still, that's a picture of the Word of God. When you find water that's moving, that's a picture of the Holy Ghost. Amen. How are we going to make it? Tomorrow morning, get up, sip a little bit. Then pray a little bit and get the Holy Ghost. Tuesday morning, get up, sip a little bit. Sip a little bit. What about it? Hey, Brother Mark, in the book of Jeremiah, God the Father is pictured as a let's see, what is it? A fountain of living water. A fountain. Did I get that right? Let me look right here and make sure that I got that right. A fountain. He said they committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain of living water. In the book of John, in chapter number 4, God the Son is not pictured as a fountain. He's pictured as the well. But then in John 7, he's not pictured as a fountain. And the Holy Ghost is not pictured as a well. The Holy Ghost is pictured as a river. Amen. I'm glad I'm not in the fountain dispensation. I'm glad I'm not in the well dispensation. But thank God Almighty, I'm in the river dispensation. Amen. And as a fountain, he fills us. Hey, well, as a well, he furnishes us. But thank God, as the river, he flows through us. Oh, thank God, if we're going to make it from the beginning to the end, we're going to have to learn how to sip. You got a little nervous right there. Y'all be wanting to get some of that water on you. Hallelujah. Did you see him? He get nervous, Brother John. And Cooper was praising God, or Jackson was praising God that you was closer than him. Sipping. I'll never forget. Y'all, most of you remember it. So the platform at camp. Oh, the kids from Brother Chris Simpson's were singing, "Lord, give me a drink of that fountain. Oh, the living water. Let it flow from me from everlasting life." And old Brother James looked over at me and he said, "Brother Mark," he said, "it's been a good while since I had a real good drink." He said, "But don't worry, I've been sipping." Glory to God. Can I tell you, child of God, some of you think just because you ain't had a big drink that things aren't good. Let me just tell you this. You'll sip enough, you won't have to have a big drink but every once in a while. Amen. Sipping, the priority of the water. What about the placement in the water? He came to her. He had some wisdom about her past. He said, "It's been fully shown to me all that thou hast done." He said, "I know." He said, "I know." What about this? He said, "I know about your travel." He said, "I know about your trials, but thank God I know about your trust." What about that? Some of us are here this morning, we're thirsty and dry, and you don't think anybody knows where you're at. Well, I've got good news. Boaz knew about Ruth, and our heavenly kinsman redeemer, Brother David, knows about our trials, knows about our travels, and knows about our trust. And right when he got done with some wisdom about her past, he had a word about her present. He said, "Go not and glean to another field." Well, the first thing he said to her was a command. Can I tell you, 27 years ago, the first thing he ever said to me was a command. He said, "Ye must be born again." He said, "Go not to glean in another field." But right on the backside of that command, there was a covenant given. He said, "If you won't go to another field, you won't get thirsty and you won't get hungry, because I made provision in your field." What about the privilege of the water? He told her to go drink anytime she wanted to. But what about this? He hadn't even drawn the water for her. It was drawn for somebody else. Boy, ain't a privilege for us just to be in. If we'd start looking at our Christian life, that it was just a privilege for us to be involved. It was just a privilege for us to be in. It's just a privilege for us to be saved. What about that? You say, well, I ain't been shipping in a while. Well, that's not his fault. Because the water's in the field. He said, if you're going to make it from the beginning to the end, you're going to have to be a sipping Christian. Number two, look at verse 14. Preacher, how am I going to make it from the beginning to the end? I think I'll get me some more water. You know why? Because I'm thirsty. Because I want to. And because it's available. You say, you already said that. I know I did. I thought it bore repeating. You know what? Your Nina is a wonderful lady. But can I tell y'all, y'all can get a drink whether she does or not. Your drink does not depend on your grandmother. It doesn't depend on your daddies. It doesn't depend on your mothers. It don't even depend on your preacher. You can get a drink anytime you want to. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. A drink. So if you're thirsty, let me just say it this way. It ain't God's fault. Go get me some more. I feel like I'm going to be thirsty again. Number two. If you're going to make it from the beginning to the end, not only a sipping Christian, but you're going to have to be a supping Christian. He invited her to the table. Verse 14. What about this, Brother John? In verse number two, she's Ruth the Moabitess. She's that damsel from Moab. But when you get down to verse 14, she's a daughter. She's not seen as a foreigner anymore. She's seen as family. Oh, yes. In 13 short verses, she went from being a damsel from Moab to being a daughter at the table of the kinsman redeemer. In Malon, Brother Mark, I said last Sunday night, Malon, he was a descendant from the tribe of Levi, and he was a nephew of the tribe of Judah. In Malon, the princely line met the priestly line after the order. Sounds like another man the Bible talks about, Melchizedek. Yeah. That's a lot deeper than I can always understand. But what about the fact, I'm not talking about Boaz. I'm talking about Ruth. She wasn't from a princely or a priestly line. She was a cursed woman, a Moabitess damsel. The Bible said, my wash pot. But he said, just come on. She went from foreigner to field, to fellowship, to food in 13 verses. And I didn't hear her singing. It's been a long journey either. It's been a real short trip. 13 verses. Notice in your Bible, a supping Christian. She sat down at the table with the Son of God. The purpose of this supping. You say, why did he have her come? Because this invitation to the table was Boaz's way of taking this relationship to another level. Amen. And the Lord's standing here today telling some saved folk, come to the table and I'll take you somewhere in your Christian life you've never been. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad, praise God? Hey, the food in Egypt was leeks and garlic and onions. That wilderness food was manna, but that Canaanite food was parched corn. That's victory food. You know what she might have been singing when Boaz reached her that corn? She might have sung about, I heard an old story She might have got to singing victory in Jesus. That parched corn, you know how it got parched? That corn had to go through the fire. That old corn is a picture of the incarnation. That parched corn is a picture of the crucifixion. But that buried corn that comes up, that's a picture of the resurrection, praise God. He didn't feed her leftovers. He didn't feed her something from the wilderness. He didn't feed her something from Egypt. He had a brand new meal that she knew nothing about. She knew nothing about. Not only the purpose. Don't settle. Don't settle for just getting in. Don't settle for just knowing that you're not going to hell. When he invites you to the table, pull up a chair. What do you think them other reapers thought? Because he put her real close to him. You say, how do you know that? The Bible said he reached her. Parched corn. What do you think all them others thought? Who is she? Don't matter what them others thought. It mattered what Boaz thought. The purpose of the supping. The prophet of the supping. Look at your Bible, verse 14 and 15. The Bible says she was sufficed. Can I say this to you, child of God? Some of you are trying to fill your belly with the world, food of the world. It'll never work. Pleasure won't work. Profit won't work. There's a hole in your heart that only the food from the hand of our kinsman redeemer will ever fill. You say, how did it change her? Her fullness was changed. I think the greatest need in our day is a spirit-filled life. It'll take care of a lot of things. Daddy, if you get filled with the Holy Ghost, you'll be a better husband. You'll be a better father. You'll be a better son. You'll be a better friend. You'll be a better church member. You'll be a better child of God and Christian if you ever get filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Boy, this week, come here, Jackson and Cooper, come here and help me. Jackson, you stand right there. Turn your back to him. Stand right here. Old Brother Sammy got to preaching this week. You grab that hand like you're shaking his hand right there. Old Brother Sammy got to preaching this week. He had me and Brother Tony. He is a preaching. It was vintage Brother Sammy, Brother Earl. He is preaching on what time is it? And he was on that preaching time. That's how he'd do me. He said, I want all you preachers stand up for 2 or 3 minutes. Well, he lost track of time. About 1 hour and 20 before he's done. You say, how good's been filled the Holy Ghost? I'll tell you, he got so happy, he got to swooning. You understand what I mean? He was a shouting and a swooning, and me and Brother Tony was holding him. But then Brother Ron, he got to talking about that revival at Brother Willard's. And he looked at Brother Tony, and he said, Brother Tony, he said, that revival, he said, that's where God filled Brother Mark as a 19-year-old boy with the Holy Ghost. And he didn't feel me right there, Brother Mark. I just got to remember him being filled. You say, is that charismatic? Absolutely not. That's Ephesians 5:18. Amen. That's not a second blessing. I done so far past the second feeling, friend. Amen. You said you ever spoke in tongues? Absolutely not. But I have spoken myself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in my heart. I've done that a time or two. Amen. And man, I got so happy. Old Brother Sammy, then Brother Tony got tore up, and we had been holding Brother Sammy, but now Brother Sammy was holding us. What are you saying? Just the remembrance of that feeling was helping me. Praise God. The fullness. Thank you, fellas. Her fullness was changed. Let me say this. Her field was changed. Because she left the table and went back to the field. You say, what was different? Well, after she had spent some time at the table, is when he walked out there, Brother David, and said, hey, boys, drop a few handfuls of purpose for her. Can you imagine when she went walking through that field in the afternoon, Brother Jordan, she said, those piles weren't here this morning. Man, there's another one. And another one. And another one. Her field was changed. Can I tell you this, child of God? Contrary to popular opinion, you'll get more at his feet than you ever will in his field. And it was after she went out there and told him to reproach or not, her field was changed. Come on, Miss Julianne, I'm about done preaching. I told him Monday, Miss Amy, you don't even know this. I told him Monday, I was the 4 o'clock preacher Monday afternoon. Man, you could tell them folks was already tired. And I told them, I said, well, I said, the old preacher told me years ago, I said, he'd gonna preach till his socks was sunk down in his shoes and soaking wet. I said, good news for y'all. I said, Miss Amy, pack me a pair of Riley socks. And I said, they're barely out of my shoes now. I said, I won't even get my text read before they're in my shoes. I mean, man, I pulled my britches leg up, Brother Mark, and honest to goodness, they were barely at my ankles. I looked like I had a pair of athletic socks on. Miss Ruth, you're enjoying that way too much. But I won't tell you that I thought them people was going to send you an offering. If you're going to make it from the beginning to the end, you're going to have to be a sipping Christian. You're going to have to be a supping Christian. But then I want you to notice in verse, I believe it's verse 14. Help me. Y'all look at your Bible. Is that not where it said she took the bread and sopped it? Is that what it said? What did it say right there, Brother Mark? What's that? Took the bread, dipped it. Dip thy morsel in the vinegar. That's exactly right. You're going to have to be a sipping Christian. You're going to have to be a supping Christian. Then you're going to have to learn how to be a sopping Christian. Miss Amy and I were in this high-class restaurant down in Florida, and I had gone about 2 days without eating because I knew that place had a 48-ounce aged Black Angus beef, corn-fed, T-bone steak, 1 pound Idaho potatoes. Glory to God. I'm about to dismiss now and go eat lunch. Amen. And I told her, I got in there. You say that was gluttony. No, it wasn't, because when I was full, I quit eating. I didn't eat past being full. Gluttony is when you eat past when you're full. Amen. Don't want nobody to go away confused. But here we in that expensive restaurant enjoying a nice dinner together. And I cut that filet off that thing. Cut it with a fork. It was so good. Then I cut that New York strip off the other side. Man, it was gone before you know it. And the waiter come back in amazement. I mean, he wanted to give me a high five that it was gone that fast. He said, who helped you eat that? I said, nobody, sir. You say, I don't believe you did it. Go to the restaurant. My name's on the wall. Amen. Amen. Brother Colby, they said, well, you got to eat a salad too. I said, I don't like salads. Bring me 2 potatoes. I manned up, praise God. Amen. Brother Lee said, show up. I showed up, praise God. And I told her, Brother Leon, I said, Mama, as much as I paid for this steak, I don't care who's sitting at the table beside us. I don't care if they millionaires. You say, what'd you do? I picked that bone up, Brother Don. In my hands. I feel, man, my hair is standing up on my arms right now thinking about it. I picked that bone up and gnawed it like my Labrador Retriever would have gnawed it. I used to watch Daddy when I was a boy. Mama would cook him ham bones. She cooked those cooked hams. You know, some of y'all younger folk don't know nothing about that, you know, but them cooked hams. And Daddy'd get cornbread and buttermilk and a Vidalia onion, and he would then gnaw the ham bone at night. Am I telling it right? Is that right? And I mean, man, when Daddy got done with that thing, it looked like it had been polished and shined, and you could put it on the porch or put it on a shelf as an ornament. And when I got done gnawing that bone, I took it. I ain't like Brother Mike. I don't like it. I don't like it. That skin of them potatoes. You say, why? Because that's healthy. Push that off to the side. So I took that bone and set it off. And then I pushed that potato skin off. And they had some of that good sourdough bread. And all that steak juice was in that bottom of that plate. I said, Mama, just close your eyes. You say, why? Because she was about to get, well, Dave, she was about to get on to me. She didn't want to see what I was about to do. Because she'd say, that's not nice. I said, not nice. I said, honey, did you see what this thing cost? I said, praise God, I want some of the corn it ate before it was a steak. And I took that sourdough bread and I just stuck it in it until it all just said, got as much as I could, and I bit it. And then I took it and then I just wiped it clean and ate every bit of that piece of bread. It was wonderful. Everybody okay? Some of you fellas are wanting to go tonight, this afternoon, to eat lunch with me. Hey, I might lead y'all into false doctrine, but I'll never lead you to a place that's bad to eat. Say amen right there. Brother Mark, it didn't say, let's get a hold of this. It didn't say she dipped that bread in steak juice. That King James said she dipped the bread in vinegar. Now we're talking Miss Amy's language, because that's the Italian restaurant where you pour that oil in there and then you pour that vinegar on top of it. And I, you know, she's such a hypocrite, because it's all right to sop bread at the Italian place, but when you go to the steak place, she says, oh no, you're not supposed to do. I said, woman, make up your mind. Stinking hypocrite, praise God. Melissa's enjoying that. Well, John, I looked up that word vinegar. That Webster's 1828. It said vinegar means anything that is metaphorically or really sour. And as much as I enjoy sopping my bread in steak juice ain't sour. What's the principle here, preacher? If you're going to make it from the beginning to the end, there's going to be some sour seasons in your life. There's going to be some times it doesn't taste good. There's going to be some times that you don't want to drink it. It's sour. But you know what she took? She took the morsel. She took the bread. Can I tell you what you're going to have to learn to do? Come here, Brother Martin, help me. Oh, I'm going to be the Holy Ghost. Y'all have always wondered what he looked like. Amen. Brother Jonathan Davis told me he married the Holy Ghost. I thought he was a man. He said, well, I did too, to Miss. Miss Kelsey told him she knew what the Lord wanted. Amen. You know what'll happen? You get in them sour seasons of your life. Let me borrow your Bible. I won't borrow a pink Bible, Brother Mark. I'm going to borrow this black Bible for you. Praise God. You're in one of them sour seasons of your life. And you get up in that morning and you start sipping. And then you start supping. But it just ain't going down good because you're in a sour time. Then here's what the Lord's going to do. The Holy Ghost is going to reach in there and get a promise. Put it in your hand. And say, if you're going to make it from the beginning to the end, he said, you take your promise, dip it in that sour season of life, and you'll be able to make it to the end. You say, preacher, I'm lonely. Reach in there and let the Holy Ghost give you that promise. I will never leave you and I will never forsake you, and dip it right smack dab in the middle of your loneliness. You say, preacher, I'm fearful. Let him reach in there and get Psalm 37:1, where it said, fret not thyself for evildoers, and dip your promise into your problem. Well, you say, preacher, man, I feel like the world's coming. Get John 16:33. Where he said, in this world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. Get you a promise. Dip it in your problem, and you'll be able to make it through. Because, Brother Scotty, there is no such thing as a Christian life without a problem. But I'll turn it over this way, Miss Joy. There's no such thing as a Christian life without a promise. The mark in my heart, but Darren, in my heart, I want to be around at the end. And I don't care if my end is tomorrow. I really don't. I don't want you to have to read my obituary and weep because I didn't hang in. You say, preacher, what you gonna do? Well, until then, until he comes, tell you what I want to do. I want to sip. And until then, I want to sup. And God help me, until then, I want to learn how to sop. And if we'll be a sipping Christian, and a supping Christian, and a sopping Christian, we'll be able to make it to the end of the harvest. The typology in the book of Ruth is just about unmatched anywhere. Maybe, probably, Brother Mark, I guess really Joseph's life and the type of Christ. But probably outside of that, probably there's just some of the greatest typology. Brother John, that field, those reapers, they're in that field. That field's a picture of the world. Those reapers are a picture of the church. And those gleaners, picture the church. And they hung around to the end of the harvest. I don't know about you, but my prayer is, Lord, let me make it to the end. You remember the old message Brother Buster preached years ago, how the mighty are fallen? Remember that, Brother Darren? I don't want to be a casualty. I don't want to be a castaway. I don't want to be a cause of sorrow for the people of God. You say, how do we make it? Learn how to be a sipping Christian. Learn how to be a supping Christian. Old Brother Leo will call me every once in a while in the mornings. A lot of times I'm in my study, and he'll just share a little thought. You don't never know how much of a blessing that was. When you do, he said, preacher, I was in the Word this morning. He said, no need to call me back. I was just in the Word this morning. And this is what the Lord gave me. You know what that was, brother? That was supping. He reached you some parched corn and said, here's your little food to help you through the day. Not no great thing, is it? Sipping. Just a little drink. Every day. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. We're standing on our feet. You say, preacher, I want to be a sipping Christian. You say, preacher, I've been waiting on that big drink again. Why don't you just come sip? Come sip and sup at his feet and let God change your field. Sing on, Miss Julian. Why don't you mind God? Some of you young people, be a good thing. Just come on down here and say, Lord, teach me now. Mom and Dad, been dry a while. Why don't you come in here and get you a sip this morning? Ask the Lord to help you. Amen.
My heart can sing when I pause.
How about it, child of God? Sipping. Supping.
A heartache here is but a stepping stone.
God help me sip.
Along
God help me sip.
Trail that's
you realize Ruth got more at his hand. Well, John, she left more with what he gave her than she had when she went out to the field to glean herself. Well, how many times can we testify that? He's given us so much more. He's a so much more kind of God. Oh, hallelujah. It won't be long. We're going to hear that old truck rumbling up the road. Yeah, man. Until the day.
My eyes behold that city.
See, it wasn't, old Brother John was a testifier. It wasn't the sound of that truck that was giving him peace. It was who was in that truck. Because he knew whoever was in the truck had the power to alter the situation. I'm glad I'm trusted in a God who's got the power to alter. You may need him to tell them, you may need to tell him to tell them reapers that you need to get their hands off for a little while. It might be all right to ask him that if you need his help. Sing another verse, Miss Juliet.
Praise the things God. Of earth will dim and lose their value if we recall their borrowed for a while, and things of earth that cause the heart to tremble.
And all of God's people said, amen. If you're planning on getting baptized tonight, I need to see you for just a minute after the service. Visitors, thank y'all for being here. I hope the service was a blessing to you, and I hope you'll come see us again. And we're just good old common folk that love Jesus. Praise God, Miss Cheryl. Yes, thank God for Miss Cheryl. Come here, boys. I need some young boys. Come here, Bo Jack, Bob Dawson, y'all four right there. Get you a plate. Now, look at here. Don't make them chase you down to put a, give them an offering. Amen. Now, this is what I want you to do. I want you to go to the back. Y'all go to the back. Y'all got your plate? There's one in the back window back there, boys. Now, look at here. We're going to take that up offering to help these youngins. And some of you didn't even have no kids that go, that went. But I'll just be honest with you. If God will help these young people, God will help our church. I'll say again in the words of Dr. Allen, you don't build a fire with backlogs, you build a fire with kindling wood. So we can see some of these young'uns get on fire for the Lord, it'd be a real blessing. So if you could, man, I'd say, Brother Mike, go ahead. Wednesday week, on the 9th of April, there's an Awana, that's our Easter Awana program. Amen. You need to come see it. April the 9th. That's the second one, all right? So what we want to do, you make sure and make plans to be here for that. Now, look, it takes probably $100 to sponsor one of these kids. If you got that, if you can't, man, if it's 15, help sponsor one of them. It'd be a blessing and help us meet the need for that trip. So Miss Julianne's going to play. Boys, take your time now. Make sure, get them puppy dog eyes out. Open your eyes up real big. And get us a good offering, all right? So y'all receive the offering when the plates come past you forward. You're dismissed. If you're going to get baptized, I need to see you for just a moment. Amen.